This conference.
Hello everybody, thanks for joining this late evening. Let me start with an introduction of what we are doing. Yeah, okay. So I welcome everyone for this training, performance testing using Nearload by Aisha Training Solutions. A little bit introduction about myself, just to give a fair idea on what's going on. Yes, so I'm Naveen. I'm a certified expert in Nearload. I'll be your trainer. I'll be walking you through all the Nearload concepts and the features, everything, and we'll be doing hands-on. Yes, and I have experience in different domains like retail, banking and finance, insurance, healthcare, telecom, logistics, etc. And I have over 600 hours of live training experience. Yes. Okay. So that's a short introduction about myself. And what you're currently seeing is my credentials. Okay. This is a in early 2019 got certified expert. Yes, okay. So let me quickly walk you through on the course content, as many of folks was really interested in what are we going to gain from this course, right? So I'll directly go ahead and start with that. Yes, so we'll be learning about performance testing concepts, right? So there are a variety of concepts which is associated with performance, and we'll be like learning using the tool Nearload, and we'll be learning about Nearload features with a proper analogies, right? So there will be an example, and there will be certain exercises which we'll be doing certain hands-on sessions on it. And we'll be learning about the components of Nearload in detail as we progress into the session. And all the sessions will be a practical demonstration and hands-on. Okay. So let me quickly open up the course content, right? So what we have, what are we going to learn from this course? Okay. So it will start with certain introduction, okay? Introduction to performance testing and then introduction to the Nearload. Okay? And then we will be learning about how to install the Nearload, and there are different components of Nearload, okay? So here, as we progress, we will be learning about the design of the Nearload, okay? So what this means is, so this is a previous batch projects. And these are the on the left hand side, what we are seeing is a series of scripts. Okay, we will be working on a variety of exercises and all of the concepts by creating a different scripts and practicing on it. So all of them will be shown in the live demonstration. Okay, for example, if we look at the correlation, as everybody is aware of it, correlation is the core part of any performance testing tool. Okay, and Nearload offers a variety of correlations. Okay, there are different types of methods which we can take advantage of. So some of them are like autocorrelation, automatic configuration, manual, advanced, and then randomization. So for every what we see, AC is the autocorrelation, and this is supposed to be the automatic configuration. This is manual correlation and advanced correlation, and there is a randomization. So for each and every part, right, there will be a script that we will create, and then we will be working on it. Okay. To continue with the content, We will be learning about the checkpoint or assertions, okay? And then there is a variable manager, which is a which can be translated to parameterization, right? So the all types of variables that we will be learning, okay? Not just learning, we'll be creating them, okay? So here, if we see, there are different types of variables. We'll be going through these variables, and then we'll be learning them, okay? And finally comes the so before we okay, so there are some of the logical actions which somebody was asking, whether if we also get a chance to learn these logical actions, right? So as you can see here, right? So from here, there is a loop, there is a random loop, there is a rendezvous point, there is a while rand, right? There is a JavaScript, a custom code, and then a try catch. So almost all of the logical actions, we will be working on it, and there will be a separate script for it, for all of these actions, okay? It doesn't end there. We'll also learn how to create a different types of population, okay, with different settings. Okay, as you can see, well, this was created in the last batch, okay, and different types of monitors, okay, and its performance counters. Then under the runtime, as some of you already know about it, there are different types of performance executions that are there. So we will be creating these scenarios in the practical session, okay? So all of these different, I mean, the most commonly used performance testing types will be created and demonstrated here, okay? And then there will be a series of executions that we will go through, okay? As you can see, right? So there is we have done, so this was done in the August, okay, in the month of August, and in the early September, right? That is this month. So we'll go with a series of executions. There are spike tests, what you see. There are other tests. There is a rendezvous, which we will be practicing them, and then changing a different policies and how this would you know, turn into effect. And then there is a different features that are associated with the results manager that we'll also learn. So here we can see so the results analysis, results manager, generating a report, filtering the results, all of these we'll be learning, right, in this. So this is what that we are going to gain from this entire course, okay? So we will start with the different types of workflows, so that we will slowly learn, okay? So so what I'm going to do is, I'm going to show you guys on a simple recording, okay?
In which application are you going to make any of these scripts?
It is a demo application which is available for free. It's just a JPET store, okay? I'm going to use that. Okay, fine. So let me show you what it is, right? So let's get back to this. Okay, so just wanted to start with a little bit of introduction, okay? Performance testing introduction. So so why do we need a performance testing is to determine the performance of the application under a certain load, okay? As we progress, we will discuss more about it. Yes, so why any business needs a performance testing, right? One is, if the business is not well aligned with the performance, then they will lose the business, right? So 100 or at least 99% uptime is something that is now has become a basic requirement, okay? The other thing is, if the website is fast, right, and it can, the specific business can create more revenues, okay. And the other aspects about any business, right, how it can be scaled, and the stability and its robustness of the business, right. Any business that fails to scale cannot grow as a business, right. For example, in recently, due to this, if we see WhatsApp's term, new terms and conditions, there was an opportunity for an application called Signal, right? But they couldn't scale it. I mean, nobody has expected such level of user intake, right? Within the given time. And definitely they were not ready for the business to scale, and eventually they lost it, right? So any business has to think about how they can scale it in a given finite amount of time, right? So this we will discuss as we progress, okay? But first we will start with the recording. So this is the NeoLoad, okay? Under this we can see three different modules, okay? Design is a module where we only create, develop, and enhance the test scripts, okay? Runtime is used to set up a different types of performance testing scenarios and then execute it, okay? And results is used to analyze the executed results. It is a very simple and intuitive design, is what we see. So let's start with the simple recording, okay? I'm just starting with the recording. Okay, I'll just use Internet Explorer itself. Okay, so let's say, something as unauth browse. So I'm going to record an unauthenticated workflow. Let's see. So as soon as we click on start recording, what we see is there is a recording bar right here, and then there is an Internet Explorer or whichever the browser that we select, right, that gets launched. Okay. So here what we see is there is a pause button which will pause the recording, stop button which stops the recording. And there is a container button recording, where these actions should get recorded. And here we can provide the transaction name, and there is a prefill and a rendezvous checkpoint. Okay. So let's start with the launch. So let me try launching. So the website has launched. Okay, I'm just simply going to browse this website. I will not sign in. Okay, so this is an unauthenticated workflow. Okay, soon in detail we will learn about the difference between unauthenticated and authenticated workflows. Okay, so for now we will just go with the tool demonstration. Okay, so I'm just clicking fish. Okay, this is my second transaction. I've clicked the fish, and then I click on angel fish. Then I'd select an item, any item. What I do is I just go back to the home page. I do not add this to cart, or I'm not planning to check it out. So I'll just go back to the home page. Yes. So there is a interesting fact about any of this e-commerce website. Okay. So this is a replica of a simple e-commerce website where they sell the pets. Okay. But if we take any e-commerce websites like Amazon or Flipkart, 98 to 99% of the traffic are just the browsers. Okay, so which means either they are not authenticated, or they are just simply browsing the websites, like maybe browsing the products or just casually surfing through the sites. So 99% of the traffic are just the folks who just simply go through the website. They are not planning to buy anything. Okay, so this is a workflow which replicates a similar thing, okay, where the user is not logged in and he's also not trying to place any order. He just want to simply going through the website. Okay, so once the recording is done, I'll just click on stop. Okay, so what this user has done, he just launched the website and then went through some of the product and categories and then just closing it. That's all. Okay, so search for dynamic parameters, this we will look at it as we progress into the session. Okay, so for now I'm skipping this step. Okay, then click on next, then finish. Okay, if I expand this, okay, so all of our transactions are recorded within the actions container. Okay, so let me explain about these components. Okay, so what a man type icon is called as an user path. Okay, a blue or a violet color folders are the containers, yellow color folders are the transactions. Okay, a document with blue ball is the pages, and as just a document are the individual requests. Okay, if I open the same website, let's say, so what this tool does is whatever that gets recorded, whatever the request and response gets recorded, the tool just simply records it and just places it right here. Okay, so let me show that. Okay, so let's assume that I am launching the website. Okay, so what we see, catalog.action is a document type. Okay, this is the main request, and followed by there are series of non-HTML or embedded resources. Okay, similarly here also we are seeing the main request first and then followed by the series of embedded resources or non-HTML resources. Okay, this will be the case across all of the all of the requests and see this, right? So if we keep expanding it, so there will be a minimum of one main request and its other non-HTML resources. Okay, so this is how a simple recording can be done. Okay, if we want to check for a replay of this, we can use this check user path. Okay, so there is a one thing that we keep changing it, the handle cache to new user. I will explain why we are doing it as we progress. And then we just simply click on start checking. This workflow is going to replicate the unauthenticated browse workflow. Okay, so what it does, it will launch the application and then clicking on a fish and selecting an angel, clicking on angel fish, select an item. So I think there is some 404. Let's check what it is. Okay, 404 not found in the launch. Okay. Anyways, we can for now we can ignore this. Okay. Maybe this request is not executing. Okay. So this is an unauthenticated browse. So as I said, as we as more and more we will explore into this. We will learn about authenticated and unauthenticated difference and the other aspects about the scripts. Okay. So anybody has any questions who want to understand about?
So you mean to say that unauthenticated workflow doesn't require any correlation?
Yes. No, it doesn't need a correlation.
Okay.
But it depends. There are cases where even unauthenticated workflows may have some certain IDs. That may happen, but highly unlikely. The idea is generally the workflow can be divided into two groups. One is when the user is identified, another one is when the user is not identified. That's the basic difference. So
Naveen, what would be the prerequisite of this training? What should one know before if we are enrolling into this?
Yes. So there is no prerequisite as anything, but ideally the folks who join the session, right, are either a beginner or maybe few years of experience, or maybe even having a lot of experience. But they just want to get the tool knowledge. But ideally, there is no prerequisite, as this is a Neoload is naturally a codeless design tool, right? Where we don't need to do any coding, or it is purely based on certain tool-based knowledge. So once we learn that, then we can easily become a performance tester or an engineer, right?
How easy this correlation in this Neoload?
Oh, it is very simple actually. So if we see, Neoload is the only performance testing tool offers different types of correlation. So as we have just seen, right, so if you can see, this is for auto correlation, which Neoload automatically does the certain operation. But for certain so when it comes with auto, right, when the tool automatically does certain things, the auto feature comes with certain limitations. Okay, so this may not be a recommended method, but there are other methods, right? There is a auto configuration. This is another type, right? So let me try to find. Okay, see here, right? So as you can see, there is a login transaction is happening here. I'll just share you the how similar it is. Okay, so this is done by auto correlation. Okay, that Neoload by itself is done this. And if we see this is an automatic configuration. However, for now it may look like a little odd, right? But if we look at the manual correlation, it is like this will be like clearly explained, and these takes are one separate session, right? so definitely it is quite simple in Neoload, the correlations. The best part is there are many different methods which is available here, where we can take advantage, and we'll be learning all of these methods, like auto correlation, automatic configuration, manual correlation, advanced correlation, and there is a randomization. All of them will be like going through, and this correlation itself will go for like 3 4.
Naveen, just wanted to know, I have seen sometimes that some mm-hmm. testers does some coder encoder URL or something like that.
Yes,
you will cover that part as well, because
yes, it will be covered.
And why does it really require that coder and coder thing?
Okay, so what happens is there are it is like the applications, right? Some applications will accept only the encoded value. It doesn't recognize the non-encoded value. So there are many types of thing in a simple way, right? In LoadRunner, probably we have come across with URL and HTML, correct? Where this the space keys are gets replaced with %2 or something like that, right? These are the this is the fundamental difference between these two, and as I said, some of them will not recognize if the value is not encoded, right? So that's why we encode it and then parse it along with the request.
So you will going to explain us that even that,
yes.
How to identify it is coded value or encoded value?
Yes, sure. Yeah, it will be covered.
Yeah, okay.
Yes,
Naveen, in some,
yes,
organization behalf of results, they are using NeoLoad web, like,
mm-hmm,
the performance center in LoadRunner, like that.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
is it covered in this section?
No,
that
NeoLoad
web
is not covered.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll let me try to accommodate a NeoLoad web, how this can be covered.
Yeah,
basic. What I am assuming is for NeoLoad web, right, it needs certain infra requirement, right? Some kind of subscription is required. Let me check on it and let me answer this query tomorrow. Yes.
Okay, no, thank you.
Naveen, what are the protocols you are covering basically here? What are the protocols you are covering?
So it's web and web HTTP HTML is the only protocol being covered.
If anything required on the mobile by using NeoLoad,
mobile in the sense, iOS, Android. Hello.
Yeah, it's covering both. They are not only specific to iOS. It will cover the both iOS as well as the Android.
Okay. For mobile, I don't think it is. It can be covered, but again, that can be definitely try to include that as well, right?
Because nowadays this client, most of them, they are looking on the mobile devices, not the web.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, true, sure.
So what is the version you are using, NeoLoad?
It is 7.10.
But the latest one is 7.8 something, right? Yeah, but this is the older version, right? It will cover all the topics?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, so before we start, I'll update the to the latest one, okay? I think it's...
Okay, no problem.
7.10 is even later than, I mean, latest version than 7.8, right?
Yes, this is the latest.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yes.
And Naveen, can we install the LoadRunner to our machine for practicing purpose?
Sorry, can we install what?
The NeoLoad to our desktop.
Yes, yes. Absolutely. So the session I will walk you through with the installation, how, where can we download the files and how we can install it, how to update the license. Everything will be shown in the sessions. It'll be taught as we progress.
Okay. Okay.
Yes. So any other questions? Folks who cannot speak, you can type it in the chat. I will answer.
Naveen.
Yes.
See, when you start the recording, so there is option. Option is there like SAP, Citrix, GUI.
Uh-huh.
So
yes, yes.
Actually, what is this and where we use, where we, you know?
Uh-huh. Those are different protocols. SAP GUI is a different protocol altogether. It's an SAP GUI protocol. And Citrix is also, there is a Citrix ICA. That is again a different protocol altogether. Okay.
So
as far as this course,
we use in this meeting, like in this course?
No. So those are different protocol itself, right? So these are not covered. So as far as this course is concerned, we are only covering web, HTTP and HTML. But if there is a sample application, right? For example, if there is a sample application which is having a SAP GUI protocol, or if there is an application with Citrix protocol, I'll be happy to help. I'll be happy to take few sessions on it, like how this protocol works, everything. The only thing is we have to get the sample or a demo application for those protocols. If we have those, then that can be done as well.
So Naveen, for other protocols, the concept remains same for this usage of NeoLoad, because everything would be same, I guess, or there is another story for that in NeoLoad.
No, for different protocol has a different different elements that we keep seeing, and it is developed NPU differently. Sorry, Sugam, I think your voice is breaking.
Okay. And yeah, actually, I'll try to type. Actually, my network is.
Okay, sure. No worries.
And Naveen, one more question. So, this NeoLoad supports the API testing also, right? Web services.
Yes. So web services is covered. Yes.
Okay.
No. API web service will be covered as a part of this course itself. We'll be having two sessions on APIs, like what are APIs and how we can create an API calls using NeoLoad. And for performance testing as well, we will cover that as well.
Okay. So is it a separate protocol that NeoLoad provides, or
no,
is it like?
No. So APIs, right? So APIs can be created and used using the web protocol itself. So this is not a different protocol.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Yeah, can you please open the curriculum once, Naveen? Can you please open what are the topic you are covering? Yeah, we didn't cover all of them. Okay. So you are covering the variable manager, logical actions. Okay. After that? What is the framework here, basically? Can you give high level?
Which one? Framework parameters?
Yeah, framework parameter.
So framework parameters are a set of rules, or you would say like set of certain variables, right? Which comes along with the NeoLoad, which also acts as a part of an intelligent, area of NeoLoad, right? So this is used for like autocorrelation, and or maybe we can create our own framework parameters, which is kind of an automated way of doing this correlation. That's the framework parameters.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
Population.
Naveen.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Actually, I heard about here we use like load generator also, load generator and cloud generator.
Load generator we will be using. Again, cloud generator needs certain credits, certain infra requirements, which is so because of that limitation, we won't be able to cover the cloud load generators. but the existing one, the normal ones, we'll be covering. Okay.
Can you come down, Naveen? Yeah, in this. After monitor.
Just 1 minute. Building a population. What does that mean?
Building a population is just like that we have seen right here in population. This is building a population. That's all.
What it is actually?
This is, as you can see, right? A population is a collection of user paths, which is like used to group certain user paths, and then for again we can use this for workload distribution, right?
It's like runtime settings.
No. Runtime is here, right? This is. You mean runtime settings in LoadRunner? Are you referring to that? Huh. Maybe it is similar to it, but it is little different here in LoadRunner. We cannot directly compare it to it, but maybe some of the runtime settings imprints are here. You'd be able to see that. And runtime is here. I mean the LoadRunner's controller is NeoLoad's runtime, I would say. Yeah.
Okay. Got it.
Yes. Yeah. So somebody was about to ask some question. Okay.
Naveen, basically, can you highlight what we need to cover in the correlation? Basically, that is any project, the scripting is the art of the project, right? Or the correlation. Basically, in the low runner, the correlation, okay. Basically, we have seen so many challenges in the low runner, okay.
Uh-huh.
But how we need to overcome in the neo load, okay. Basically, what are the, can you
highlight,
what you want to cover in the correlation module? Based on that, it would be a little bit idea. Yeah.
Yes, we will be working on around five exercises just on correlation. Okay, so that will cover majority of the challenges that we see on a daily basis. Okay.
So I am hoping that you are going to take correlation in as much as detailed as possible for you.
As much as what?
Detailed, whatever the concept.
Absolutely, absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So, Rohit is saying is my voice is not enabled. I'm not sure. I think everybody can hear me, right?
Yeah, Devin.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, great, fine, sure. Okay. So we'll take one more question.
Naveen, how many days session it is?
Yes, somebody was asking about this. So there will be like a minimum of 20 to 22 sessions, right? So we will be having around 20 or two or three sessions more, okay? And weekly minimum four sessions would be there. Okay, if not more. So there will be a break during the weekday, but weekends again there is a break, and for each session we will be having a hands-on session. We'll be practicing certain things, and then there will be a question and answer session like of around 15 minutes where the learners can ask their questions and they can get their queries clarified. And if somebody is facing some issue on their NeoLoad, right, maybe installing issue or some problem, right, we'll be able to troubleshoot together. We can work together like post the session, and it will be a learning opportunity for others as well, right? When we are looking at some challenge or something that we are trying to resolve, that also creates a very good opportunity for whoever is participating in that. So there will be a hands-on session, a demonstration, and concepts explanation. After that, Q&A sessions. And after Q&A sessions, there will be a troubleshooting session. So this is how the daily, everyday, the sessions are designed. And as I said, weekly 4 sessions. So we will be having, so the course will go for 4 to 6 weeks or 5 to 6 weeks. Yes.
Hello.
So daily 1 hour session. Daily 1 hour or
9 to 10 same timing.
Sorry, I think multiple folks were speaking, so I couldn't hear it properly. So, yes, Sugam, yeah, you were saying something.
So, timing would be 9 to 10 same time every day?
Yes, yes, same time.
Not earlier we'll than coming. I'm okay with that, but not
no,
earlier
no.
than
No.
Okay.
9 p.m. to 10 p.m. But if the batch members wants to keep it a little early, we can do that as well. But then we have to take it as a collective decision. Yes.
No, I won't be having otherwise. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, definitely. I mean, it is up to the folks, the participants. I'm flexible with the timings. I don't have any issues. If you want to prepone, can be done. Postpone, that can also be done. Yeah. But I think 9 is a very good time. Or
9 to 10 is the comfortable to all.
Absolutely. Yes. Okay. I think it's not for me, I guess. Naveen Reddy was saying something. Okay.
Then I mean, so 9 to 10 comfortable also.
Oh, okay, okay, great. Okay, sure. Okay, I will take one last question, then we will continue with the demo from tomorrow. Yes, so any more clarification about the course that you have?
Any CI/CD topics that you're going to do?
No, this is just a tool oriented sessions. CI/CD we are planning, but that takes some time and to include with their normal course. Okay. Fine. So what I'll do is I will be sharing the course content in the group shortly. Okay. Kindly go through the course session, course content. And if anybody has any more questions, you can post it on the group, or we can, while we connect tomorrow, we can get it clarified. Yes. Thank you everyone for joining.
Just one quick thing. When yes. you are going to start with this course, and for how many remaining demo classes will be there?
So we will be having 2 more demo sessions. So tomorrow there will be a demo session, and then we will plan if more demo is required, we will do it. Else we will start with the regular session. So what I'm assuming is there will be 2 more demo sessions for, you can evaluate it. And after that,
what all things you are going to cover in those demos other than today's topic?
So I'll just continue with the regular topics, right? From tomorrow, maybe I'll start with one correlation and some other aspects about the course. But after, once the regular session starts again, we will go back to like day zero, or kind of where we download and install, and from the basics we will start. just for the demo, there will be some you know, tool based demonstrations will be happening. Okay.
And when are you going to start the main classes?
Yes, that is probably by Monday or Tuesday, right?
Okay.
Yes, so we'll be starting soon. There will be a major break. Yeah, I hope I answered the question. Naveen, you have any questions?
Yeah, we started the session up to starting, I mean,
your voice is so feeble, it is not clear.
The session will be starting, or else we need to go for any scripting.
Yes, we will be starting with the scripting. Yes. Okay. Fine, everybody. Thanks. Thanks for taking your time and joining this demo session. We will be having a demo again tomorrow. So I'll see you all tomorrow at 9 p.m. Yeah. Thank you very much.